Silkie, if track and trace has been proven to be effective in other countries, why is there a problem with it here?
The problem has been that I think the basic standards haven't always been in place for what you would expect. And that was certainly the case for test and trace, which it was found, thanks to Jim's work and an open rights group, didn't actually happen lawfully. So there wasn't a privacy impact assessment in place, which means we don't know exactly how it's going to affect people's rights. The critical thing here is that privacy and public health are not in conflict here. You need to be centering privacy and data protection as part of any public health efforts, because medical confidentiality is the bedrock of public health. People will not be open with their doctors. They won't be providing this very sensitive data that they're being asked to provide if they don't trust what's happening with it, or if they're hearing these stories, as we've seen, that contact tracers are sharing people's personal information on WhatsApp groups, on Facebook, etc. That kind of stuff can't happen. We've seen government be very good at ushering in extraordinary emergency powers in these huge data collection efforts, but not very good at putting basic safeguards in place. And that needs to change if we're going to get on top of this.
Well, Jim, let's go to you. Do you think we need to keep moving forward?
Of course we do. And you know, we've never said anything other than this programme should carry on. We know that these programs are needed. Our worry is that, as Silkie said, people won't trust it because the safeguards aren't in place. People's data is being collected and people don't know how it's going to be used. We've had pubs and so on use this data, anything from building a marketing database through to stalking their customers. You know, that's the sort of behavior that brings the whole program into disrepute, and then people will feel discouraged and they won't participate. Now, all we're saying is the government has been very irresponsible here by failing to get those basic safeguards in place and to make sure that the data security is there. We've seen stories that show that clearly they haven't managed to do that, and that, of course, endangers their whole program. So it's not about privacy or health. It's health depends on people's trust.
But Jim, won't it take too long? I mean, we're familiar with this argument from, you know, Citizen 4 and the rest of it. Won't it take too long to get a perfect system in place?
It's not. Nobody's asking for perfection. What we're asking for is basic organisation. You look at a country like Germany, which has done incredibly well in dealing with this crisis. It has also put privacy ahead of many, many considerations and made sure that everybody has complete confidence. You know, for instance, it took a privacy app and chose a method where the data was going to be minimized, and it's got millions of downloads. We did the opposite, tried to gather all the data in the UK. The program collapsed and we've got nowhere. So, you know, you have to take privacy seriously. You have to put it, you know, at the center of what you're doing rather than think of it as an adjunct, or you end up in a sort of chaotic delivery that we're seeing.
Silkie, we've given away an incredible amount of freedoms, I guess, during lockdown. Do you think it's possible to hold back the tide? Like, once this data is out there, will we be able to take it back? Or do you think the horse will have bolted and that'll be it?
That's the critical question. My concern is that there's no easy off switch to any of this, and there's no obvious end to the public health situation that we're facing. If we put into context the general assault that there has been on our liberties, and don't get me wrong, a lot of the emergency measures obviously have been needed, but I would argue that many of them have been over the top and some have been unlawful. And if you put into context then programs like Test and Trace, we've also had, as Jim mentioned, an incredibly intrusive contact tracing app that cost the public £12 million that failed. We've had drone surveillance. People are now being asked for names and contact details when they go into bars and restaurants. We've already had to write to some of those premises because women have ended up having unsolicited text messages. People being asked to scan QR codes when they go into shops.
But don't the ends justify the means? I mean, we're trying to stop people dying.
Yeah, of course, but there's a lawful and proportionate way of doing that. And everyone's talking about this new normal. Okay, I think that we, having experienced the greatest loss of liberty in British history, the new normal that we want to see is that we have a freer future, not that we end up being some kind of dystopian surveillance state where we are increasingly tracked, monitored, and so on. We need to be really careful of that because these are massive, massive programs. We've now got big tech in the NHS, Palantir, Amazon, Google, creating huge databases that we know very, very little about. Of course, we want to support the public health efforts, but these are big, big changes that raise big questions that aren't being answered. And that should be a concern for all of us.